Though in my mid-40s, I'm only in my fourth year of a faculty position. I'm a community-based advocate turned intervention scientist, having spent over a decade working alongside survivors of sexual and domestic violence who experience health disparities and often struggle with a wide range of seemingly unconnected health conditions. What motivated me to return to earn the PhD? A gnawing feeling that health justice for survivors was elusive. We were missing something. I remember one of the last calls I took on the crisis line shortly before returning to school. It was from a survivor who had suffered repeated physical abuse and molestation at the hands of her father, and she struggled to find a mental health counselor who could help. She attended support groups and dropped by the agency unannounced just to talk, always with the sweetest smile on her face. Yet, she was shaky on her feet, and I always felt like she was having a difficult time focusing her eyes. She was young, too young to be taking a smoke break. That afternoon, when I took her call, she had been notified that her father was back in the state. She was hysterical. She was drunk. She was alone. She was suicidal. Having been failed so many times before, she felt hopeless and did not believe that any health or service system could help her. So I sat there and talked with her for a long, long time. That day, I vowed to figure out what we were missing. How could we help her? How could we alleviate the suffering of so many violent survivors like her? I'm here today to talk with you about the transformative power of community research partnerships, a necessary relationship to make visible to both community advocates and research scientists what I've discovered neither of us could see on our own. Sexual and domestic violence, two types of interpersonal violence which disproportionately impact women and children, are public health crises, the burden of which is inequitably distributed. The same populations that develop disease and die at higher rates due to structural oppression experience more violence, including those living with disabilities or in the Appalachian region of our state, racial and ethnic minorities, those in the LGBTQ community, or those trafficked for labor or sex. So when I share with you that one in three women in her lifetime will experience sexual or domestic violence, that rate is much higher for some. My first funded research project occurred through happenstance. The Ohio Domestic Violence Network received a federal grant to build a program to help advocacy organizations better meet the needs of domestic violence survivors with mental health and brain injury challenges. They brought me in as an evaluator initially, but after I heard what they wanted to do, I made a suggestion. I would take the project through Human Subjects Research Review in order to be able to more generally disseminate our findings. Despite initial skepticism, their trust in me and OSU as a research institution has led to discoveries that neither of us could have achieved on our own. Our first step as partners was to conduct a needs assessment. We held focus groups with staff at domestic violence service organizations to ask them what they knew about and what they would need in order to support survivors. Then we interviewed survivors about their needs. I remember the day that our community research partnership changed both community advocacy and brain injury research and rehabilitation forever. The ODVN team and I were sitting in their conference room reviewing summary statistics from the survivor interviews, and I remember feeling completely overwhelmed by what we found, embarrassed even, having worked directly with struggling survivors for over a decade. I'm going to show you the data. It will probably shock you too. We asked survivors, how many times in your life have you ever been hit in your head or were made to have your head hit another object? Only 3 out of 20 people had never been hit in the head. That means 17 in 20 had. And half of those had been hit so many times they couldn't remember. Blunt force head trauma followed by altered consciousness results in traumatic brain injury. It's the same story when we look at choking and strangulation. 17 out of 20 survivors seeking services have been strangled. Oxygen deprivation from strangulation results in hypoxic anoxic injury to the brain. We went on to discover that survivors often experience both kinds of assault concurrently and repeatedly within the larger context of toxic stress and coercive control. Brain injuries, though each unique, cause cognitive, emotional, and physical problems, and even if identified or treated, can lead to comorbid issues like substance use and suicide. While chronic brain injuries are pervasive among domestic violence survivors seeking services, advocates were missing them. And all of our service systems, safety, criminal and civil justice, health, social service, have been set up assuming survivors have intact neurologic function. How can we expect a survivor to find safety, justice, or healing if they have an unrecognized brain injury? This community research partner discovery led to the creation of CARE, a health justice advocacy intervention to assist domestic violence program staff in addressing the health needs of survivors. CARE works for a wide range of health issues by taking brain injury into account. Because of CARE, I started asking questions in my research with homeless youth who also experience intersecting structural oppression. Among these youth as well, brain injury from interpersonal violence is highly prevalent and is associated with mechanisms known to impact behavioral change success. By bringing the tools of scientific investigation to community sites who serve populations burdened by the intersections of injustice, interpersonal violence, and disparity, we've brought hope. Visible on the faces of survivors when they realize that they have an invisible injury, one which can be mended to alleviate pain and despair. We've discovered the missing piece. Brain injury, which was invisible to the community advocate alone, is now visible through scientific inquiry. However, the story doesn't end there. I dare say that our community-based discoveries have also made visible missing pieces within brain injury research and within clinical brain injury response. In light of this, OSU's Chronic Brain Injury Program has embraced our discoveries and is positioned to be a world leader in scientific discovery regarding brain injury sustained through interpersonal violence. A missing piece is now visible to all of us in community-based clinical and research settings through the transformational power of a symbiotic community research partnership. We need the community as much as the community needs us. And when we work together respecting the insights the other brings, all of our worlds are transformed. In my case, I'm convinced we've discovered a mechanism fueling health disparities among our most vulnerable populations. And our community research partnership will be the foundation upon which a more equitable future is built. As leaders at a land-grant research institution, isn't this the highest ideal we can aspire to? As those engaged in creative inquiry, I encourage you to build transformational, mutually beneficial partnerships, ones that will bring together community and research to make visible that which neither can see on our own. Thank you.